Я нарисую, всем все будет понятно, и мы будем 4 часа обсуждать, что это такое. Okay. Ну, короче, каждая фасада, она одна и та же. Да? Мы вчера разговаривали, как это, it's a transfer of value, it's magic, it's mystery, it's relationship, it's trust, it's a lot of things, right? But in reality, it's all the same. So, say a cell starts here, right? And it ends here. So this is the opening, and this is the promise ring. Okay? So when you start right here, in the beginning, right? What is your goal? It's impossible, right? You start a sale, okay? You say hello, right? What is your goal from there?
To get money?
You get to the promised land, right? You want to get right here. We want to get to heaven, right? So what do we got to do to get to heaven? Obviously, there's going to be a couple steps. Can anybody tell me when a sale really does start? So like, let's say we have opening here, you have your company, you have your product, and you have you, and then you have your excuses. I don't call them, you know, objections, like, not right now, I don't have money, I gotta talk to my wife. Big problem in America, everybody has to talk to their wives before we make a decision. Just the American way. Yeah. Okay, so you have your opening, you have your company, you have your product, you have your excuses, right? Where do most of you, well, let's start with Bosch, right? Where do you get the first, like, wall? Когда они говорят, не-не-не-не. Или тормозят тебя, они не хотят тебя пустить дальше. Как бы у тебя это, когда ты про компанию говоришь, когда ты про товар рассказываешь, или когда ты себя продаешь, или когда ты отвечаешь на их, как бы, вопросы, уже до сюда дошел.
По-разному.
Ну, есть averages, right? So, like, there's an average on everything. So you get something 10 times, 20 times, 30 times, you get an average. What's your number one stopper? Like, when do you get stopped? Or I don't have to focus on you. Does anybody want to volunteer and tell me that way?
I don't have time. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I'm in the middle of something. I'm sorry he's out of the office. He's having his lunch. Lots of objections.
Okay. So we can deal with that. We can deal with that in the first 4 seconds. So remember I said there's 4 words that only salespeople use, right, to distinguish you as a salesperson. It's how are you today, right? How, if I'm, are you, whatever, you, today, okay? I can't write, so this means how are you today. Nobody ever calls their friend and says, how are you today? They say, как дела? What's going on? What'd you do yesterday? Da-da-da-da-da. So when I call, I never say, how are you today? I say, Mr. Prospect, you sound busy. I hope I caught you at the right time. And I know most sales training is going to tell you, you don't give them an open-ended, like, question. Are you busy right now? Do you have time? Because they're most likely going to say, I'm busy right now, right? But we're not selling pancakes. We're not selling toasters. We're not selling anything quick, you know? We're selling, what do we sell here? What do we sell here? Anybody tell me what do we sell here? Do we sell programming? Do we sell expertise? Do we sell people? What do we sell?
Excuse me. Sell
could you elaborate?
In company, in product, people,
well, like these exist in every sale. It doesn't matter if you're selling socks. It doesn't matter if you're selling, you know, real estate. You got to get the threes. You got to get the threes into tens. Okay? So here's what that means. There's only 3 tenants to this sales system, right? For, on a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being I hate it and 10 being here's my money, right? You got to get the company to a 10. You got to get the product to a 10, and you got to get yourself to a 10. Okay? So you've got to think your product is the best thing since sliced bread. You guys have sliced bread here, right? Okay. So the product got to be the best thing since sliced bread. Company's got to be the most trustworthy, the best. We never did anybody wrong. Everybody's happy. We have a 99.9 success rate. Here's where the sale kind of dies or goes on. It's all about you, right? And sales, it doesn't matter what the product is, right? So we're almost done with the training anyway. We decided to do the 4-minute version instead of the 4-hour version, all right? Okay, so just to catch you up, right, you weren't here. Every sale is the same. It starts right here with the opening. You go straight down the line to the promised land. Where do you get a problem? Like, I heard you on the phone yesterday. You're on the phone all day. You have the hardest job in this building, right? It's very monotonous. It's repetitive, you know? Where do you get stopped, right? So you start right here in the opening. You present the company. You know, as far as my company goes, Oxygel is the best thing since sliced bread. Then you present your product. Okay, we have the best developers, PHP, Java, blah, blah, blah. And then you present yourself. Let me ask you, when you're on the phone, when you're setting appointments, как на appointment the dealers, да? Ты продаешь все три? Ты продаешь как бы компанию, товары, себя? Или у тебя в один из этих трех где-то больше всего фокус? Куда ты внимание больше всего уделяешь? Ну, ничего себе, по-русски, по-английски, так как-то...
Чего, понимаю.
По-украински, по-моему, была. Спрагин Зелёвич. Живу по-французски. Камичево. Yeah, so where do you get do you present the company, the product, and yourself? Or do you present the company and the product? Company and product? Okay. So the company has to be a 10, no matter what, right? In your mind, at least. Before you can sell somebody on an idea, you have to sell yourself. So all of you guys got to know deep down in your gut that Oxygel is the best thing ever. Even if nothing's perfect, even if sometimes things don't go right, you have to be sold, completely convinced like a maniac that this is the best company in this country, right? Because if you believe that, the customer is going to believe that, right? So this has to be here either way, because if it's not, you know, quit and go somewhere else where the company is a 10. Because you shouldn't have to justify that your company's good, you know? So what about the product? Would you say we sell a similar product to other companies?
We don't say that we sell. Because we don't like when you say that I'm selling something.
Okay.
Just at the beginning. They will stop you and say that we don't take such calls of selling.
I am Mr. Prospect. I just want you to understand this is not a recommendation call. We're only calling to find out. We sent out some mailers last week, and you're one of the last people.
Then we explain like that.
That hasn't yet. Because if you say, I'm not selling anything, that's like saying, how are you today? You know, it's the same wall that goes up, right? So instead of saying that we're not selling anything, it's just you use a rebuttal, right? Like the scripts that I gave you guys yesterday, right? Have any of you guys read the scripts? The ones, right? Do you think it will help to use a script every time on a call?
Not really.
Why do you say so?
Well, actually, I think that they are pretty much Americanized, if I can say so, because mostly this script won't work for Europeans, mm-hmm. because they like talk a bit differently.
Well, I can talk like this, say, hello, my name is Alex, I'm calling from the best companies and sliced bread, it's the same shit, you know? Like, it doesn't matter what their accent is, you know, or what their mentality is.
Let's talk about accent.
Well, let's talk about mentality, right? So people have needs that need to be met, right? They need to know that your company is trustworthy. They need to know that your product is worth the investment. But number one, right, where most people fail is right here, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. They need to know that you're an expert, you're sharp as a tack, and you're the guy that can help them. And I'll give you an example why you need to sound like an expert, right? Let's say you have a medical injury and you have a choice. You have a medical student that just graduated medical school, and you have a 20-year veteran doctor that's been doing this and putting people who are you gonna go to? Are you gonna go to that medical student that just graduated, or are you gonna go to like Dr. Lecker? You know? Like, you're obviously gonna go to the expert, right? So in the beginning I asked, where do you guys see it get the most pressure? And maybe for telemarketers, you haven't been here yet, but it might be the reason why you're not generating as many appointments. Company might be good. The product sounds similar to other companies. But are you the expert? How do you introduce yourself? You mumbled your name, and then you go into, well, we're calling for Montagel, we're looking to see if you have any needs that could be met. Same thing that every company says, right? I would say, good morning, Mr. Jones. My name is Bogdan. Let me introduce myself. I'm a senior solutions advisor with Voxagil. I'm just following up on an email that we sent out last week. I'm following up on a newsletter that you received last Tuesday. I'm following up on a convention that we bumped into each other. I know you're a busy man. So I'm busy, objection, right? Take care of that. I know you probably get 1,000 of these calls a day. Objection, I don't take sales calls from blah, 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 blah. But let me tell you why I'm different, right? So, I gotta draw this here. So you say, let me tell you why I'm different, right? So let's say this is again the line, right? So if I start the pitch here, I start the pitch with myself, I transition once I get his trust into the company, then I talk about the product, then I answer any kind of questions. It never happens this way, because life isn't perfect, and they're gonna stop you, right? So what do I do? If they stop me right here, I say, well, let me just say this, and I go back to pitching the company, right? As far as my company goes, my company's been around for blah, 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 we do blah, 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 and here's why we're the best, and you start to build another case. So you just go right back into your pitch, because people need to hear things three times. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna use the rule of threes. You're gonna just loop three times back and forth. So, boom, you're pitching again, and they're gonna say, well, I'm not really in the market for this product right now. Well, the beauty of this program is, and you just start pitching again. So every time you get an objection, you just loop, right? But every time you loop backwards, the loop is gonna get smaller, your argument. Как бы, то, что вы презентуете, оно должно быть точнее и больше всего как бы убедительное, да? То есть здесь, если в начале, in the beginning, it's just a vague presentation, да? И мы идем дальше. И он нам говорит нет. Да, первый раз он сказал нет. И в реальности я спрашивал, где продажи начинаются. Продажи начинаются, когда человек говорит нет. Потому что вот здесь девушка, по-моему, сидела, да? Она сказала, я хочу, чтобы в мире было все так красиво, солнечно. И вот люди просто давали мне деньги и брали товар, да? Но в реальности это называется ритейл. Вот идешь ботинки покупаешь, это все. Это не продажа. Продажа это когда у тебя resistance. Когда тебе надо убедить в чем-то, да? Вот они говорят первый раз нет, и вот твой сейл наконец-то начинается. То есть ты берешь свой скрипт с подготовленными правильными словами, которые выбраны именно сбить человека off track. Well, let me say this. I plan to be the best solution advisor at Oxygel, and I'm not gonna get there by being wrong. And you go back into your pitch. You know? They say, I already have a developer. I hear what you're saying. I just want you to understand this is not a sales call. We just want to get some information out to you so you can take a look at our business record. You see what I mean? Because you guys aren't selling the product. You're selling an employment, right? And then when Pasha calls back, right? I know you spoke with Nika. I know you spoke with Bogdan. They're one of our top appointment setters, and I'm sure you had a good time speaking with them. So let me just reinstate what they said. And Pasha says, the beauty of the program is, and you list back what Nico or Bogdan said when they were on the call, just to reinstate those feelings. Because your initial job is to get the company to attend, is to get the product to attend, and now you're going to get yourself to attend because you're an expert now, okay? So Pasha, or myself, or any other salesperson, is going to call back and he's going to congratulate you. Мы вас поднимем вот так вот, да, что вы типа самые классные, которые есть, мы это подтверждаем. У Паши теперь с тех вопросов, qualifying вопросов, которые вы записали, он теперь знает, что им надо, да? То есть и он сразу в это войдет. Он не будет говорить там, что он на рыбалку ходил, он не будет там говорить про что-то чушь какую-то, потому что эксперт время свое зря не тратит. Пойдешь самому классному эксперту в мире, он не будет с тобой про хоккей говорить. Он будет с тобой про тему говорить. То же самое мы будем. Мы не будем просто так тратить время. И Паша начинает опять подтверждать, что ты эксперт. Он идет как бы задом. Он начинает подтверждать the product, and he's going to say, well, as far as my company goes, I just want to reinstate again, Oxygel is the best thing since sliced bread. Any questions so far? Let me ask, am I doing this in a way that makes sense?
Yes,
okay. Okay, so when does the sale start?
First meal.
Okay. What's the biggest objection that you get on the phone? Well, really.
We are not interested.
Okay. Well, maybe you just don't know enough about my company yet. Let me send some information out to you. You know, let me show you why you should be interested. What else?
We have partners for it. We do everything in-house.
Well, let me answer one at a time. I understand that you have a lot of partners, and believe me, we're not trying to become your only developer. We're only trying to become a backup option. When the first one fails, you need to have a fail system in order to keep your business moving. You have things in-house? I understand. You're a businessman. You already have a structure set up. But just in case you need more people, you should have somebody you can trust on speed dial to call. Any other objections? You guys only get two objections?
Not in the market right now. Mm-hmm.
Okay. But when you are. Okay, so not in the market right now. But when you are, see, the beauty of this program is that we've been around for 9 years. We have 35 successful startups, blah, 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 blah. Продаешь опять. Идешь, да? То есть, your goal, ваша цель, это идти прямо по этой линии. Любой excuse, они вас сбивают с линии. То есть, you're going off into space. You know? They're either going to give you an excuse and take you off the line, or they're going to start talking about their family. Take you off the line. Have you ever, Pasha, right, in your sales conversations, did you ever have a time where you just started talking about God knows what, and it's like it has nothing to do with them signing a contract, it's just pleasantries? Mm-hmm. Have you ever had that?
At the start of the call, but not later.
Okay, so for you it goes like this, right? And then you say, let me introduce myself, and then get back to the line.
No, I don't think it's that much of a curve. It's just kind of breaking
Let's
the
ice.
Let's
do it like this, okay?
It's like, how are you doing? It's a bit of how are you doing, what the weather is like. It's especially what you need to do in Europe. You don't go right into the core of the discussion. I don't know, they kind of feel insecure if you jump right in.
How do you interact with the information that was already provided by your appointment center team?
I have, often I have details of what these people would be interested in and what kind of topics they would look to have in the agenda, and then I just build the agenda based on that.
Mm-hmm. Do you introduce back into the conversation, like let's say, what was her name again?
Julia.
Okay, let's say Julia did a great job. She built massive rapport and people loved her, right? Do you introduce Julia back? Okay. On a sheet, does it say who made the appointment?
Sorry?
На этой бумаге, которой ты говорит, вот этот survey, который делали, там говорится, кто делал appointment?
I know who did the appointment.
Okay.
And we call this a survey.
Try, because it's gonna, you're gonna look like a team. Instead of just like parts working separately. You guys want a break or like?
Where's the line between building this kind of connection? I do say that you've been speaking to Lena or something like this, asking what do you know from Lena about our company? What more is there? No, how to do this correctly? What would the, I don't know, the script look like?
Mm-hmm. Well, instead of you saying, hi, how are you doing today? You sound like a salesperson. This is Pasha calling from Oxygel, just calling to check up on the information that you received from Lena. Okay, so if Lena did a, if Julia or Lena or Nico or Bogdan did a good job, right? They got the 3 tens. All those feelings are gonna come back, right? So like, you ever had a time in your life where you got like, something happened to you, right? And then you see something on the street and it's like deja vu, those feelings come back again, right? So sales is emotional. So once you say, this is Basha from Oxygel, I just wanna call back and reaffirm, double check everything that Lena talked to you about. In their mind, they're already supposed to be here. I just want to introduce myself. I've been with the company for blah, 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 blah. Da, 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 da. Let me ask you, what did you think of the information? Well, maybe I took a look at it, maybe I didn't take a look at it. You know, we already have people that we work with, and then Pasha says, I understand you're a busy man. The beauty of the program is that we've been around for blah, blah, blah. He goes back into the pitch. Or if they say something else like that, in the script, right, there's transferring words. You can say, well then, or well. I mean, does that make sense to you guys?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me ask you again. What hurts the most when you're on the phone? Где у вас такая неудобность, как бы, да, вот в животе такой вот, вот на телефоне, вот. Что-то случается, ты даже не хочешь следующему человеку звонить. Что вас останавливает от этого? Rejection?
Rejection when we get a reply, for example, go away, never call us again. I know sometimes it happens we call into the wrong companies. It may happen when we just start calling to them, but if we call to the right company, it should not ever.
Politely explain. Okay, we are outsourcing company by ourselves, blah blah blah, sorry for that, no, no, we should be luck. Это вот обычно случается. А чаще всего, если ты звонишь какому-то чуваку, ты до него дозваниваешься, с какого-то перепугу он сам поднимает телефон, когда это номер, который указан на сайте компании General, не его мобильный, ничего. You went, no, 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 I'm busy, so many people are calling, don't call me again.
No, в этом случае я говорю то, что хорошо, ты busy, но я тебе пишу какую-нибудь информацию, потом я тебе позвоню завтра. Ну, типа такого, если я успеваю, так сказать.
Вот именно, да,
я все равно ему позвоню.
Mr. Prospect, I understand you get thousands of these calls. I would start worrying when you stop getting thousands of these calls. That would mean something is wrong. We're contacting you because you're the perfect person we can help. We know we're very compatible. We took a look at your company. We know that we're a good fit for you. Only thing we're asking for is that you take a look at the information. If we fail to impress you with our business track record, we promise we'll never call you again. We do need a common courtesy of taking a look at my information. Как бы не должен быть sales человек, да? You can never sound like a salesperson. You have to sound like a friend or an expert, right? So this is you. You have to be sharp as a tack, enthusiastic as hell, and you have to be an expert in your field. That's how you get it to a 10, right? Your product has to be the best thing since sliced bread, it has to fix their pain, and it has to not cost more than the competition. Are we the most expensive product? Are we the cheapest product? We're right in the middle, right? Your company, it's already done. The website tells a good story. You guys look professional. When I speak with leads that come from Misha, people are telling me that the website looks great. On paper, you guys look like experts, things of that nature. So this stuff is done, right? Maybe I started backwards, right? Why do you guys want to be in sales or are in sales? Was this just an accident? I mean, do any of you guys even want to be here? Let's start from this and go around like that. We'll do a little. Why are you in sales, Bogdan? What happened in school that was so bad that made you want to get into sales?
When you used to university.
So by chance. Okay, so is there anything else you could be doing besides this? Why do you see potential in sales?
Well, 50-50. I mean, I'm more into working on some, well, things like translation, stuff like that, where I can focus on doing something and do it like really, really, you know.
You're more of a technical person.
Not really technical, but the, ну, отношение больше такое, то есть я люблю работать над, над какими-то там продуктами, вещами, то есть.
Linguistic Institute, please. English.
Haven't been sleeping ever since yesterday.
I went to bed at 5 in the morning, big guy. You know what I mean? Had a very good time. Okay, so you're here because you went to the Linguistic Institute. Do you see any kind of, like, do you think this is a salesperson? When you see this name, right, is that a salesperson or is that a computer guy?
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think he's more of a salesperson with the presentations he made and the pens.
Nobody knew what the hell this dude was talking about, right? So his product was not at a 10. Nobody knew what the hell computers, computer like chips, UI, whatever operating system he was trying to pitch. Nobody knew what Microsoft was. It wasn't a 10. But there's three things, right? So what did Bill Gates have at an absolute 10 that made him who he is right now?
Himself.
So when this fails, and when this fails, what do you have to rely on?
On yourself.
On yourself, right? That's why you have to sound enthusiastic as hell, be sharp as a tack, and an absolute expert in your field, right? Bosh, why are you in sales?
I didn't plan this.
You know what? In America, it's the same thing, right? people go to car dealerships, not? They go to sell cars because the warehouse is not hiring. So, они идут продавать тачки, потому что какой-то они кирпичи ему дали работу, чтобы уложить кирпичи. Правильно? Да? What about this guy? What about this guy? Is he in sales? Warren Buffett?
I don't think so.
Warren Buffett's not in sales.
I'm not following him that much, but I know he's an investor.
Do you know who he is?
He's an investor.
He's got a lot of money.
Yeah.
Is it all his money, or is it money that people gave him to invest? Mm-hmm. So the guy was 18 years old, read the Wall Street Stock Exchange on the newspaper, and got his neighbor to give him $20 to invest, right? So the guy's 18, he has no company, has no product, all he has is just self. So his neighbor gave him 20 bucks, and it started that way. He convinced other people to give him 20 bucks. Invest, you can start from, that's why I love America, right? Any like country where it's capitalism, right? You guys have capitalism, right? It's here,
I'll
think of it.
See, that's the wrong way to ask. If I could show you a way to turn your 20 into 100, would you have $20 to invest? Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
If I could show you a way to do X, if I could tell you how to do this with this much resource, you don't ask. It's like, would you, why? You don't sound like an expert, because would is not a
trigger.
It's not a trigger, right? But it's not what an expert says. Mm-hmm. Your doctor doesn't say, would you like some medicine?
Sometimes they do here.
In America, they do a lot. That's why we have so many doctors in jail. They give out too much medicine, right? Okay, so this guy is a master salesperson, because having the ability, having the confidence in yourself, right? He was 18, he didn't know anything, he sold newspapers door to door prior to that, right? He read the Wall Street Journal, he got excited. Oh my God, Mr. Prospect, we just had an exciting opportunity. I really want to take 2 minutes of your time to tell you about it, you know? Because you sold yourself. Your soul, you have energy, right? So, what is his name again? So everybody so far is in sales by accident, right? This just happened. Okay, Marina, why are you in sales? And don't tell me because the Linguistic Institute, because, I don't know, you got lost on the way to the bank or something, you work for a bank, and
no.
Oxygel happened.
This profession is kind of universal, if you can say so. You can sell in any industry, whatever you want, if you know the main principles on how to do this. So it's like diversification, if I can say so.
See, that's the best answer so far. You're not just saying that to make me happy, are you? Like, you're not saying that because that's what I want to get.
It is also connected with emotions, because I need emotions. I need to get emotions through communication with people. And when I get the deal closed, this is the best emotion I can experience.
Yes. That's why I do it. Because, like, I don't do drugs. I don't jump out of planes anymore. But when somebody gives me money just because of what I said, I don't know how to draw a tongue. But so, like, I said blah, 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 blah. And it transferred to this guy, and money came out of his pocket, out of his pocket, my mouth, into my pocket. Isn't that the best feeling ever? Wouldn't you want to learn how to do that in your everyday life? Nika, what did you get into sales?
It was back to the next show. I was looking for a job after graduating from linguistic university.
Oh, I love it.
One thing I know for sure, I don't want to do a translation because it's so boring. You just, all you have to do is sit and translate. It's not up to me, it's not up to my character. I need something more that involves communication with the English speakers, all the stuff. And I've been offered a job in sales. I couldn't actually believe that I got it, but I loved it because I dealt with Americans mostly. I worked for American market, and it was interesting and challenging when you talk to different people. That's what I wanted. That's what I liked.
So it's something new every day, right? New stories.
Yeah, new stories, new people. The work can seem monotonous, but it's not. You keep repeating doing the same stuff all day, but the feedback from what you do can be different.
Why do you come back in the morning? So you're done with work, 5 or 10 p.m., whenever you're done, and you come back the next morning. Why?
Because I'm interested. I'm interested, I'm result-oriented. When I succeed in something, I want more. I have to do more. I have to put more efforts to do it.
Why are you in sales?
Well, I can say that that was also an accident a bit early, because I wanted to get to linguistic university, but then I changed my mind and went to Belarusian State Economic University. So basically, I have my diploma in sales. So, like after getting this diploma.
Why do you come back in the morning? It can't just be a paycheck. You can make money anywhere. Donate.
Well, yeah. Well, basically, yeah, so I come back just like hoping that the day will bring something, like some results. So that kind of challenges.
Does anybody want to be rich? Like, does anybody want to have like lost D's or D's or whatever the best currency is? Or does anybody want to be rich?
Sure.
Okay. Can you tell me one person that ever got rich, besides, you know, somebody had to steal or whatever, blah, blah, blah. Tell me one person in history that got rich without having to convince somebody that they should trust them with some collateral, some capital, something. Can you name one person? See, when I asked that question in America, everybody said, good, this dude, this dude. And they они всегда говорят про баскетболистов там или про бейсбол, ну, про какой-то футбол или что-то такое, да? Но если бы этот футболист не мог продать своего коуча, if he couldn't sell his coach on his skills and convince his coach to take him off the bench and put him on the field because he was enthusiastic as hell, he was sharp as a tack, and he believed that he was an expert. So the coach gave that basketball player a chance, he gave somebody a chance. That's what it makes sense, right? So, like, we've been at this, damn, an hour already, okay? Like I said, I can do this in 4 minutes, but it's just since we got 8 hours to do this, I'm like dancing around. Okay, so it starts out with this. I understand you're busy. You probably get lots of these calls. You go into your company presentation. You sell yourself again, as far as I go, blah, 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 and then the sale begins. They say no. They say no right here. So if they say no to you, you know, well, let me reintroduce myself. You do a loop right here. If they say no to the product, I already have this product. I already blah, blah, blah. Well, the best part about my product is, you do a loop right here. If they say no to the company, well, as far as my company goes, maybe the reason you're hesitant is you don't have enough information about my company, you know? Give me the chance to send you some information. If it's not the best thing you've ever seen, word of Jesus, I will never call you again. It'll be over, right? Is this how you guys usually look at sales? Like, if you have to draw sales on the board, what would sales look like? Let's start from you. I haven't asked you, right? What does sales look like to you? Do you have, what is your position? What do you do? What do you do?
Sales manager.
You're sales, right? So, how do you see sales? If sales, you know, you have 7 steps or 12 steps, whatever, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Is sales a line? Like I look at it, some people look at sales as a pyramid. You know, you build a foundation with facts, blah, blah, blah. Then you get to the emotional one, and then you get the money right here. So how do you visualize sales?
I didn't understand the question.
Okay, visualize. Я еду домой пьяным, да, но я доезжаю туда, потому что я ехал по этой дороге сотни раз. То есть я знаю поворот. В моей голове уже эта карта есть, да. То есть когда я продаю, я это делал, может, больше 1000 раз. Я вот так вот с человеком вот так вот сидел, да, и я ему что-то втуливал, да, машины там, хаты там. Крышу будем строить, моргичи, то все, да. И у меня всегда вот это вот в голове. То есть я иду по прямой линии. The shortest distance between one point and another is a straight line, right? So, how were you trained? Were you trained to say, hello, how are you? Have you heard about us? Let me ask you 10 questions. Or like you said something about 22 questions, right? Yesterday before or a day before, they trust you. I never heard that one before, but maybe there is like a 22 question, you have to trust me strategy. I never heard of it, right? But do you understand the question now?
Okay.
How do you see sales?
Рассказать так, как я вижу, или как у меня это происходит в последнее время?
Ну, как ты это видишь, как он, ну...
То есть любое, ну, может быть, мы можем разобрать, например, пример из жизни, да, то есть вот то, что ты говорил, это, ну, как сказать, классическая такая схема, но на самом деле дорога не одна и та же все время. Каждый раз у тебя новый человек, и каждый раз новая ситуация. И нельзя сказать, что ты там пьяный едешь по одной дороге и выучить один и тот же текст, один и тот же скрипт, и тарабанить его каждому кастомеру изо дня в день. Это не так. Ну, то есть, вот, например. Могу привести пример жизни. Вот, например, вчера у меня был кол с компанией из Бельгии, которую мне назначил Богдан, да, то есть просто чтобы вы понимали, как у нас это происходит. Телемаркетеры, они, скажу, то есть созваниваются с какими-то потенциальными заказчиками, презентуют им нашу компанию, да, то есть рассказывают о наших сервисах и так далее. Далее идет письмо, follow-up этому человеку, правильно я говорю, да, который согласился вот на этот appointment, но это не личный appointment, это именно, то есть уже как бы повторный звонок, да. То есть он пишет, наш там аккаунт экзекутив Екатерина там позвонит нам завтра в такое-то время, вот ставит меня в копию, все, дальше я уже как бы сама с ним общаюсь. Вот. Ну вот, значит, вчера, да, то есть товарищ помнил, что с ним общался Богдан, все. Такая была ситуация, то есть невозможно было даже рассказать про Oxagile, что мы там самые лучшие, все. Он поздоровался, и он тут же начал рассказывать про свою компанию, причем так быстро, что как бы перебить его и что-то вставить про себя, да, когда я это попыталась, он сказал, мне Богдан все рассказал, он мне все выслал, я все про вас знаю, все. Дальше пошли вопросы, то есть конкретно там, как вы делаете это, как вы делаете то, как что, какие у вас цены, ага, я работаю там с вендорами из Украины, Бельгии и из Испании, кстати, вот первый раз, да. Пришлите мне это, пришлите мне то, значит, в данный момент проекта нет, ну, может быть, там через 2-3 месяца. То есть, ну, вот, как бы вроде objection нет, то есть был разговор, все, ну, вот он говорит, ну, в данный конкретный момент ничего, ну, ждите.
Это человек professional
shopper. Это professional, да, это после CTO, да.
Ну, это professional shopper. Он, как бы, вот как я представляю, да, отвечает на их excuses, да, сразу, перед тем, как они их ставят. Вот этот человек разговаривал с очень много компаний.
Да, да, совершенно верно.
И он слышал одинаковые вот эти скрипты, вот эти методики, да, и он сразу начал тебе давать ту информацию, которую бы ты у него вынесла
да.
Через это самое, да.
И на мой взгляд, перебить его и сказать, нет, вот вы послушайте еще раз про Оксажа, ну это было бы уже боль вообще.
Никогда не перебивай клиента, да, в любой ситуации, пусть они могут поносить, да, они могут говорить там бла-бла-бла-бла-бла, но где они по линии, да, вот если я в голове вот этого держу, да, вот я хочу идти вперед, бабки, да? А они сбрасываются по линии, они начинают тебе говорить, assuming that they know what you have. right? You will do them a disservice if you don't say this, oh, I understand that, that sounds fascinating, but as far as my company goes, or let me just reintroduce myself, or the beauty of this program is, and you can repeat back some of the things that he said, right? I understand what you're saying. He started spewing here. If you let it go here, meaning you're not an expert, meaning you're just a salesperson. You're not a consultant. You're not an advisor. You're a salesperson because you've allowed him to tell you your job. That's not his job to convince people. It's not his job. If you do this, if you don't gather that information yourself, there's no rapport. You guys know what rapport is? Look at the area, скепто строит, да? То есть, когда ты добываешь сама вот эту информацию, ты строишь доверие. Ты спрашиваешь вопросы, которые заставляют его думать, которые, может, новая какая-то информация выжимется. Потому что мы же не такие, как все остальные.
Нет, конечно же, были вопросы, но мне просто вот интересно, что в таком случае могло бы быть, сделать, да, чтобы как-то вот он, ну не знаю, ну...
Mr. Customer, that's, you know, that's a very interesting fact to bring up, and we'll get to that. But let me first introduce blah, 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 you know? Or let me please answer these questions first. Before I can make a suggestion, I would like to, get to know you and your company a little bit better because we may not be the right fit for each other. So stop it. It's okay to walk away. You can walk away, okay? I just want to make sure that we are the right fit for each other. So let me just, ask a couple questions. Let me find out. Do me the common courtesy. I just ask you a few of these questions because the last thing I want to do is waste your time. Or mine, you know? But you gotta say, or mine, like it's nothing. You know, you just drop back like that. So like, do you think that would've helped you if you would've just stopped them and say, hey, can you do me the common courtesy? Allow me to ask, just for my benefit and yours, allow me to ask the questions that I have in mind. Just to get them back on the line, or, yes, no? Okay. Вот что, вот пока ты вот это мне рассказывал, да, как ты это видишь, я вот это написал, вот старая схема sales, да, ADA, вот, attention, interest, desire, action, все это видели, да, потому что в Беларуси в 80-х годов, как вы учите, как бы схемы, да, и все такое, вот может вы вот это вот видели, как бы, A, B, C, да, люди устали от этого, да. Вот interest. Interest – это вот Богдан звонит, спрашивает, у вас есть interest? Mm-hmm. У вас есть интерес?
Да.
У вас есть desire? А потом Паша звонит и спрашивает, вы будете делать action? Понимаешь? Ну как можно позвонить и спросить делать action, если вы не подтвердите, что у него desire, что у него есть интерес, что у него внимание к тому, что вы спрашиваете? Right? Now, what do you imagine in your head when you take the sales?
When I just call at the beginning, or?
Ну как бы должна быть схема. Я после этих тренингов, да. Я хочу, чтобы у вас в голове была какая-то схема.
At the beginning, I feel just that I should introduce it, the company, and I would like to get that interest. And if I feel that he's interested, then I feel myself more confident and I feel like relaxed, yeah? Then I can speak with him, like you say, like friend, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
But if I feel that he is like, you know, like tension, then I feel myself not so comfortable. And then I say also that, okay, maybe guys, you don't need us now, but in the future, just to keep us in the list, I'll send you some information. You just, if you have time, just look at it. And then we can, I call you in some period and talk about it, just like that. So I imagine that introduction, then there is like, you know, interest or no interest, but if there is interest, you should keep him on that line of interest so that not to drop that. And then if I feel that he's really interested, of course I will set up that conference call. And but the reason sometimes I can't get all the information I need from him, yeah? I can ask him some questions, but
maybe he knows that I'm not, for example, a salesperson, so he will just, then I feel that, okay, I will lead him to salesperson. So I try to ask him questions, but it depends. Some people can say, some not.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's take that scenario, right? So Bogdan, you're the telemarketer, okay? Mm-hmm. You're calling her, she'll be the client, okay? You'll play out that scenario. You'll go, you know the script because you don't read it, you know, you memorize it. Yeah, the phone instruction did 20 years, right? You remember what that client was like that you just described to me, correct? Call the client and go through your pitch. So pick up the phone. Mm-hmm. Do it. Well, just play with it. Pick up the phone. Say, ring, 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 and then you answer. Hello?
Ring, 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 ring.
Hello?
Hi, this is Bogdan from Oxagile, a software development company. Do you have a couple of minutes to talk with me?
Yeah, sure, I have.
Well, I'm calling you from a software development company. I'd like to ask you a couple of questions about your development environment. Could you please tell me how you develop your products? You do it in-house or you use any partners? Or
what do you guys do actually?
Well, we develop web and mobile solutions on Java, .NET and PHP, and also on mobile platforms. And we have some big names our clients. So we work with Google, Discovery Communications, Disney, Telecom Argentina. So, I was just wondering if you guys need any help in your development activities?
Actually, I think that now we have all our project done, but maybe in the future, yeah, your company sounds quite interesting to me, and I heard already about you maybe a year ago, so that sounds interesting for me, but I'm not sure that currently we have a real need for that. You don't have project to outsource. So.
Well, maybe I can send you some information about us, maybe a couple of case studies, just so you may...
maybe not.
No,
maybe not.
No, thank you.
Bogdan, so say this, right? Mr. Customer, I hear what you're saying. What you're saying is you don't know enough about us at this point to know if you are interested or if you're not interested. Believe me, this is not a sales call, it's not a recommendation call. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna send you out our business card with our track record on it. Fair enough? So say that to her, right?
Okay, so maybe you just don't know
enough
about our company to have like a full image. So maybe if I could send
you... No maybes.
Okay, if I could send you our business track record?
Yeah, sure. Do you have my email?
No, if you could give me your best email address, I would certainly...
Okay. David at
oxagile.com.
Okay. What do you say after you get the email?
That I will send information as soon as possible.
And I'll touch base with you.
Okay. Well, you don't say excellent. Well, just to confirm, I'll be sending your track record, and I just want to instill the confidence in you again in my company, in my product, and blah, 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 blah. Okay? So this is safe zone. Everybody's safe here. On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate how Bogdan handled his call to the customer? So,
я просто все про свой пример думаю, вы не ответили на вопрос, я не могу сказать.
Okay, we'll get back to that, because it was a good image. We will get back to
that.
Что Богдан сделал не так, или что? Не-не-не, мы не обсуждаем правильно или неправильно, да? Ну просто вот с 1 до 10, да? Где 10 очень скучно, no confidence, he's not enthusiastic as hell, he doesn't sound sharp as a tech, he doesn't sound as an expert, that's 1. And 10 is you're sharp as a tech, you're enthusiastic as hell, and you're an expert in your field. So from 1 to 10, where would you rate Bogdan? just real quick, off the top of your head, what's the first number that comes to your mind?
It's a safe zone, Pete.
Safe zone. Safe zone. We're all friends here. Safe zone.
I won't be hurt.
Judgment free zone.
Ну, может, тут не в школе, чтобы оценки ставить, я не знаю.
You just entertain me. I flew 8,000 kilometers to show you what the best people do when they train killers on the phone. Okay? So just entertain me. From 1 to 10. Would you say it's a 3, a 4, a 5, a 6?
Maybe it's better not to give him a mark, but just what
okay.
I feel that he
would
does.
You say it's Adna Zvezdochka?
No, just I feel lack of confidence in his voice. So because he repeats it maybe and they don't like
maybe,
it.
Maybe, right? So maybe. What else? What other things did
он
we hear?
Перечислил. .NET, PHP, Java, это делают тысячи компаний. Он должен был говорить, мы поможем вам сделать то-то, мы сократим ваш кост
we'll
то-то, мы там сделаем.
Not unique. Ага, писать вообще не умею. Но, what else?
To sound more enthusiastic, so mm-hmm. that I feel more interest in that, actually, he starts with questions, and maybe I don't like questions, so
okay.
I would like to hear the introduction, just complete the introduction, then I will be ready. Maybe the customer will be ready for the questions, but that shouldn't be like the questions and information, so
mm-hmm.
it's just like, you know, there is no order. For mm-hmm. he calls me and he asks me questions. Maybe I'm not ready to answer to that question.
Okay, but here's the thing, right? Let's assume that Bogdan was right here. He was sharp as hell, he was enthusiastic as ever, and he was an expert in this field, right? And now you're an appointment, you're an opportunity, right? Pasha, call the opportunity and qualify it and take it through your sales process.
Hey, David, how are you doing?
Hi, fine, you?
Good, thank you. Thank you for being available for the call today. It's great to be speaking with you.
Thank you, too.
Yeah. I have information from Bogdan about your discussions before, and let's decide how we structure this call. How would you like us to proceed? Would you like to have more information about our company, or would we discuss your requirements and your business?
You know, I've got some introduction, and I've already heard about your company, but of course, if you repeat some of more specific information about Oxygen, I'll be more glad to hear that, because Bogdan, he gave me some brief information, and what you actually, I mean, with what companies you worked, and could you just give me a whole picture of that?
Yeah.
For example, recently, not just a year ago, but now.
Sure, we're an active company, and many of the of our clients are well-known brands, and you'll recognize them. Since we have WebEx launched, do you mind if I share our slide deck?
Yeah, sure. That
would
be interesting.
So I'll typically run through the slide deck, which is organized in kind of pages. Well, you know our presentation.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe I'll first switch to the client's slide with
mm-hmm.
this.
Well, let's stay in character, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Let's stay in character.
Okay.
Let's assume you did the PowerPoint presentation. But here's the thing. During the PowerPoint presentation, most people ask questions. What are the typical questions that would be asked during the presentation?
Typical.
What are your reads?
Mm. Okay, so you do the PowerPoint presentations too, right? And you're like, okay. So can we switch? Just because
yeah.
she knows the PowerPoint presentation. Let's say she's the client. You're pitching her on the phone. Because I can see she wants to explode. I want you to be so mean to him. I want you to be the worst client. Very bad. Pressure, okay? Pressure makes diamonds. Let's make some diamonds over here, okay?
I'm going to disqualify a bad client. Because the production will never, never work well with a bad client.
I'm
why?
Busy client, not bad. Not busy.
Yeah, yeah.
So I have 20
just
minutes.
Busy.
I have no
busy
time
and no money.
Well, look.
Busy and broke.
People with money don't have time.
Of course.
People with time don't have money. Okay, so your bad clients, the ones that are rude to you, is because they're getting these calls 1,000 times a day, is because they're worth the time. Okay, so I don't disqualify, I build rapport. Okay, so So I'll talk about something else. Okay? So let's start with the PowerPoint. So you're going through the PowerPoint. What's the first objection you usually hear during the PowerPoint, or the first question, or the first interruption?
Not all the clients have time to listen to all PowerPoint presentations. This is the
so say to Pasha, it sounds great.
It sounds great, but I have only 20 minutes, so try to be short.
5 minutes.
Это очень polite, я бы сказала. У меня был такой кейс недавно, вот как раз с таким очень занятым клиентом. I don't want to listen to all this information. I know you're the best company in the world, so let me know what I need to know. What I rate, how I'm planning to work together, and all this.
Okay, so Mr. Client, let me get this straight. You would like to know how much, when, and how we're going to work together, right? And that's what I'm here to provide. But first of all, before I tell you how much, I need to know for what. What exactly are we going to be doing? What's the expectations? For when, I'd like to find out how you usually choose your vendors so we can see if we're available, because we don't want to hold up your schedule. And for how, well, we're an international company, we have international delivery capabilities, things of that nature. I'll be glad to send you information on that. You can take a look on your own time, because I understand you're a busy guy, you get thousands of these calls. I'd worry we'd stop getting thousands of these calls. Stop. You know? Well, я там пример, да? Вот я когда продавал construction, да? Вот я захожу в дом, да, и вот моя нога трогает дверь, значит, у меня часть пича такого, так? Я всегда это самое опаздываю специально. Oh, traffic was so bad, you know? Did you see what happened on 95? И вот это вот мой как бы conversation, да? То есть я не то, что вот странного человека с наколкой на шею сейчас дверь будут пускать, да? Они такие, о, о, да? Я такой, о, hi, Betty. You know, у меня такой громадный мешок был с окном вот таким, да, который я разбирал, да? И я такой через дверь хуярю, вот так колено, вот так. Hi, Betty, did you see what the traffic was? I'm sorry, right? Okay. I'm like, so I'm here from Castle, you know, we're here to take a look at some windows today. We're here to help you improve the energy efficiency at your house, save you a little bit of money. But first of all, I'd like to show you what not to do. Are you okay with that? Okay, let's go to the kitchen. Because the kitchen, I like to eat, but right? But the kitchen is where the decisions are made. That's where the families sit down, and that's where they discuss business, right? So I know business is not going to be done on the couch in the living room. So I take control. I take control of the client. I don't ask them, should we go in the kitchen? I'm like, oh, I got a few samples to show you. And I just stroll through their house. You know? I'm stepping over kids' toys, you know, kicking the dog out the way, you know what I mean? So I get there, right? I sit down. I'm like, Betty, would you mind giving me a cup of coffee? Why?
У нас бы это не прокатило.
Ну, прокатило бы. Вот через пару лет у вас то же самое будет. Я захожу, говорю, cup of coffee. Опять, я control. То есть эта тетя меня первый раз видит. Да? Я еле представился. Но я ей уже рассказал историю, которая вызывает жалость.
Еще и кофе болит, да?
А? Ну кофе, ну конечно, я же в трафике был.
Застрял, опасно вообще.
Я нервничал, мне надо чуть успокоиться. Да? Плюс я еще прошу кофе, знаешь, чтобы время дали. Потому что кофе горячее. А я горячее кофе не пью. Мне надо, чтобы оно остыло. То есть это мне дает хотя бы 20 минут. It opens up a window, you know. Windows, once they open up, they start to close, you know. And once that window closes, it doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter what you do. You can't get through that window. So am I going to talk about how my window is the most energy efficient? Or am I going to talk about how we have the best developers? Am I going to talk about how, like, we've been around for 50 years? No. I'm not going to talk about any of that. I'm going to ask, So what's not working with what you're currently doing? What would you like to change with what you're currently doing? I'm trying to find pain. I'm trying to find problems, you know? With Windows, it's super easy. You come up, there's a hole in the window, they got a problem. It's easy. I'm like, oh, Betty. Standing here drinking my coffee, I'm like, Betty, you got a problem over here, you know? You got a hole in the window. You can't do that all the time with that, right? So how do you find the problem? I'm going to ask you, how do you find the problem, right? How do you find the pain? Because your only job is to solve problems as a salesperson. Huh?
Ask the right questions.
Ask me a question. I work for Yahoo, and I need 40 developers.
Okay.
I don't have enough time, but I'll give you 15 seconds.
Good. How soon I plan to start working with the whole team?
First, second quarter.
Okay. What is the technology? What is the skill set for, technology skill set for those developers?
Well, we're debating about what technology to use. See, my brother actually said that Java is the best thing to do, but my uncle's nephew's cousin's brother-in-law, he said that PHP might be good. So they're experts, they're family, they come to Thanksgiving dinner, I trust them, I don't trust you.
Okay, so anyway, we will be able to give you advice with the technology, so that you will have the right...
Well, what do you got? What are you selling?
To the right choice. And my last question to you.
Three questions. You're good. You're good.
I have only 20 seconds. Yeah.
Why do you have 15 seconds? Why don't you ask me for a cup
it's
of coffee?
It's the time when the attention will be catched. And when you can find out the information you need to proceed, to define next steps with it. And how will you choose, how do you usually choose the vendors? So how will you choose the vendor in this case? So how will you understand that we are the right provider?
Well, you know, I definitely don't do it on price, because price doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I don't want anybody too expensive, but price doesn't matter, contradiction, you know. Well, we usually look at the track record. That's how we choose companies.
Okay,
how do you usually sell your company? Mm-hmm. I'm the client. I'll be the client. Drink my coffee.
It depends.
At any time, if anybody feels uncomfortable answering a question, or if something is like, you just say pass. You know, because I don't know what the threshold level for Belarusians is on pressure and things of that nature. So, like, if anybody ever feels pressure, just say, I'll pass. Fair enough? Cool?
Yeah.
All right. Does everybody feel pressure so far?
No.
All right. How about a smoke break? 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Cool?
Yeah.
This is risk-free. It's virtually risk-free. What are the main words that you guys use when you speak to English-speaking people to minimize the risk? Like, so let's say I'm calling on the phone and it's a startup company and they have, you know, they just got financed, they got a little bit of capital. And they're like, oh, I don't know, Alex. We don't want to lose our money. We're choosing very carefully. I'm like, fuck. Let's say I'm completely wrong on this, right? Now, my company will underperform. It's not going to do what I say. It's not going to do what you want it to do. What's the worst thing that can happen? I mean, is this going to land you into the poorhouse? Are you going to go out of business because you trusted your development to us? Nobody's going to say or admit that they're going to be in the poorhouse by making this decision. Only if I say, Bob, trust me, there's no risk in this, then the wall is going to go up because they don't trust me, they don't know me. When I say, virtually, there's no risk in this. Virtually all of our clients have a high success rate. Virtually all of our startups that we work with will go further or launch, whatever, get big. Virtually impossible. I love the word virtually. You know what I mean?
So what words do you guys use right now? Or do you guys not have any words to like minimize stuff? Let me go through a couple I wrote down, all right? Mm-hmm. It's impossible for me to remember all of this and like just speak, da-da-da. Okay. So the word only, it's not $50,000. It's only $50,000. It's not money out of pocket. It's a cash outlay. It's an investment. So your cash outlay is only $10 billion. Your initial investment is only $1 trillion. You ask me a question that I don't have the answer to. I'm not going to say I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say, that's a great question, Bob. I would be glad to research that for you. These words, I would be glad to. It's a rapport builder. I'll write that down. Basha, you're writing that stuff down, right?
Yep.
Okay. I would be glad to research that for you. Why would I say, I don't know? What do you think that causes? When I say, I don't know, does that make me an expert?
No. Doubt.
It's doubt. What else? Lack of confidence? Maybe it's lack of confidence? Okay. Okay. What if you tell me, sounds like a lot of money. I don't know if I want to invest that right now. Well, why don't we start off small? It's not going to cost you a lot of money. It's going to be a small cash outlay to further your vision in the company. Let me go back and ask you, what is your vision for your company? Where do you see yourself in 5 years? If I have been optimizing your development procedure for the past 5 years and successfully saving you money, you wouldn't be asking me right now or telling me, let me think about it. You would most likely be telling me, Alex, let's get started on this new project. Correct? Okay. So the problem here is not that you're not ready, you don't have the money, right, or blah, blah, blah. Anything that stops me from the money is because you don't trust me, right? So he says right here, I don't trust you. Mr. Prospect, let me reintroduce myself. I plan to be the top solutions advisor at Oxagel this year, and I'm not going to get there by making bad recommendations. And as far as my company goes, you go back into the, it's a loop. Он вас слушает, но в реальности, когда вы на телефоне, вас никто не слушает. Первый раз вас никто не слушает. So you say, as far as my company goes, is that helpful to you guys, what I just explained?
Yep.
Okay. Use the words. Virtually is a good word. Cost is a bad word. Charge is a bad word. Cash outlay. Fantastic word. Makes you sound smart. Investment makes you sound smart. So where would you use this? Like, let's say Pasha, right? Or I'm only picking on Pasha because I forgot your name.
Yes, the third time.
What is it?
Marina.
Marina. So your LinkedIn profile, that's right. Everybody looks so different in person. Yeah. I wore my suit on Monday and I was going to be like this. That's the profile picture from LinkedIn, okay? In what situation would you be able to use virtually?
When I have some concerns regarding our, or probably when I have the lack of information. So this is a kind of suggestion, if I understand it correctly, from my side. When I say virtually, for me it means that I need like more research, more investigation on this issue. But for the customer, it sounds like.
Are you selling to the U.S. market or are you selling to like another market? Because it could mean different things, like in UK, it'll mean something totally different than in America.
I work with both markets.
You work with both markets, okay. So for UK, I don't know. I saw British movies, but that's about it. I can do a pretty good British accent. You know? But for like the American market, they like words that they can read in the Wall Street Journal because it makes you sound smart. Especially these very technical people, they have a very technical mindset, and when they hear the word cash outlay, it's different than any other salesperson that they heard before. So virtually, your cash outlay is going to be only X. You know, your initial investment is going to be only blah, blah, blah. Well, that sounds like a lot of money. Bob, let me ask you. If I have been continually optimizing your development process or reducing your HR cost or whatever for the past X amount of years, when you say that, okay, if I have been, so it's in their mind, they're playing a mental picture. We watch movies in our head all the time. So in their mind, they're playing that if game. If you did, then I would. They're saying, so if this guy has been optimizing my research for this many years, we would be X, right? So I'm building trust already because he knows me from 5 years ago. Let me ask you, Bob, what's the worst that could happen? Let's say I'm completely wrong, you know? Let's say I'm out of my mind. I'm crazy. I don't know what I'm talking about. What's the worst that can happen? Is this going to put you in the poorhouse? Is this going to bankrupt your company? Or is this going to be a benchmark for future business? Let this one transaction serve as a benchmark. Benchmark of the college. So it's just we're in the sales process here. We're in the sales process here. When I say the word benchmark, all of this already had to be at a 10, right? Mm-hmm. Because when I say the word benchmark, this solidifies everything, okay? Let this transaction serve as a benchmark for future business. And then you go back into your pitch, okay? Where do you see that you could use that terminology? Let's say the words that I just used, right? Let's say I have been optimizing your process for the past 5 years. You wouldn't be telling me right now, I have to think about it. You wouldn't be telling me right now, it's a lot of money. You'd probably be telling me, okay, let's start this project. Okay? Do you see where that language could have helped you anywhere? No? Does anybody see the language that I'm using that could help them anywhere?
That sounds more better than just, for example, when we say, when we ask about the rates.
We usually don't speak about such general things. So it's really, that should be really a general conversation. So some like topic like the weather or something.
Wait. Business. You're saying that you shouldn't talk about business. You should talk about.
We should. The reason why I'm saying, what I'm trying to say is that usually the customers have some definite needs and they would like to have the answers to their questions in order to make the decision. And there are not so many cases when we can use this terminology in terms of our conversations that we have with them.
Mm-hmm.
So we can speak about the investments with the startup companies, but they usually don't require such a terminology. They are very simple. They want to be like light and easy. Yeah. Okay,
we're all people. It doesn't matter if we're big people, if we're little people. It doesn't matter. You're not selling to companies.
Mm-hmm.
You're selling to people. So people all have the same emotional triggers. They want to feel safe, secure, and light. So in order to make them feel safe, I'm going to take them into the past, right? I'm going to go back into the past and say, if I had been doing this for 20 years for you, you wouldn't be saying, hold on, let me think about it, or hold on, I'm busy, blah, blah, blah. Because I'm your trusted advisor. I'm your expert. I'm here for you, Bob, you know? Let me ask you, right? When you're selling, so, can I ask you, are you ready for me to ask you? When you're describing, say an entrepreneur calls in, he wants to be the next Google, right? He wants to build something great. And he comes to you on a napkin. I want to be the best things in sliced bread, right? And you're describing a system that we're going to build. How would you describe, just take your most recent case, whatever, right? How would you describe that system to that person? How would you describe their vision to them? Okay. Bob, we're going to hold your hand all the way. We're going to hold your hand all the way. Step by step. We're going to show you the ins and outs. Show you the ins and outs, right? There's going to be a huge upside, little downside. It's going to be incredibly easy to get started. We're going to give you an in-depth training program, meaning we're not going to leave you alone. We're not going to do this for you and go away. We're going to take you by the hand. We're going to be your trusted advisor. We're going to take you by the hand and show you the ins and outs of exactly how the system works. We're going to give you a by the numbers, paint by the numbers. When you're calling into America, say this, paint by the numbers. Paint by the numbers of the data сумку, где номератакие вот эти сделаны, да, можно. It's that easy. It's virtually impossible to fail. There's huge upside, there's little downside. It's a cash outlay. So for this cash outlay, Bob, we're going to take you by the hand. We're going to take it step by step, ABC, and we're going to make sure we do everything possible for you to be successful with the system. Can these words be used in your conversations?
Definitely.
Yes.
Yep.
Sure. Well,
okay.
Sometimes.
Sometimes?
Yeah, because...
Do you close all the time?
Well, when I'm... At least maybe last 4 or 5 times I've spoken with French or Belgian people, they were always like very suspicious and concerned about the way we will work with them, because they're like really suspicious about nearshoring.
And what did you say when they said, did they actually say the words, we're very suspicious?
No, I mean, I'm like answering to your question, basically.
I asked if you can use these words.
Yes.
So, like, let's say, right, the client didn't tell you specifically that he hates you, that he doesn't trust you. He only trusts his mother and his brother, right? Nobody else will he buy development from. So, he's going to wait till they learn how to do IT, right? I would say, Mr. Swiss cheese guy, I completely understand that you don't know me and don't trust me. But believe me, if you do even half as well as my other clients, we will never have to go back to the issue of trust again. Now let me reintroduce myself again to you. Because the first two times you probably didn't hear me, you know? If you do even half as well, if I have been, they're all ifs, you know? Mm-hmm. So like, what Bachman said is very good, you know? Has anybody else had a similar situation, like Bachman?
Oh, sure, sometimes.
How do you guys deal with it? Do you just keep going on into your pitch? Do you slow down?
Slow down and trying to explain.
Next time somebody asks you a question, or does something that stops you, you stop. And I want you to count 4 seconds in your head, right? Mm-hmm. Silence is deadly. Mm-hmm. You know how you watch TV shows? And before they announce the winner, it's like da 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 da, да, и там пауза, и они идут в рекламу. И ты такой сидишь и думаешь, что будет дальше.
Да, вот бывает, потому что ты разговариваешь с контактом, и он молчит. И у меня такое прямо, думаю, так, ему интересно, либо ему вообще не интересно. Ну, 2 варианта, либо да, либо нет. Ну, как бы вот это вот, это правда, то, что когда молчание, то есть ты не знаешь, как себя повести, но ты просто как бы ему говоришь, он просто молчит.
Where does it happen? Где больше всего они молчать начинают? Когда их спрашивают commitment, да? Когда какой-то commitment, когда вы просите, maybe Monday, would Monday or Tuesday be better for appointment? And they're sitting there. А вот эти 4 секунды как бы бег, да? То есть надо делать то же самое клиентам. Потому что они не должны чувствовать comfortable with
you. Да, то есть как бы вот преимущество. Они mm-hmm. чувствуют преимущество, ну как бы мы не чувствуем преимущество над ними. Mm-hmm. Потому что, может быть, ну я понимаю, что нет такого там experience, да. Вот, то есть как бы я хочу чувствовать себя более уверенной, ну, в разговоре, чем он себя чувствует. Mm-hmm. Бывают такие, которые там friendly, ты себя чувствуешь как бы тоже open-minded, там.
Вот я хочу вот подтвердить вот это. You want to sound more confident
yes.
than the client does, right? Yes. If you know what the client knows, and you know what you know, who knows more, you or the client?
You.
So you know twice as much, mm-hmm. correct? So why wouldn't you have a script? Everything in front of you, why wouldn't you stay on the line? Uh-huh. Do not deviate from the line. Mm-hmm. The only
so it's normal to use every time because
yes.
Mostly I don't use. I mean, sometimes I use, but just you repeat the same things and you get used to that. But and of course I don't want to make the client feel that I read something or I check something, you know. So
it sounds scripted.
Yeah, not sound like reading.
Well, let me ask you, right? Do you like movies?
Yes.
Do you think those people are just in front of the camera, just doing whatever they want to do, or is there a script that they're reading? Mm-hmm. But we believe those people. When our heroes die in movies, which is why I like Russian movies, because the hero always dies, you know, or American movie hero dies. I like Russian movies because the bad guy wins, right? I like the movies where the bad guy wins. We get emotionally attached because of the words that they train to say. They do not, most of the time, they do not deviate from the script. When you watch a DVD of a comedy, you know, at the end of the movie, when they show all the people that were there, they show the scenes that did not make the movie, right? Mm-hmm. Bloopers. They're called bloopers. Ошибки. То есть смешно. Людям было смешно, когда они что-то должны были. Они сказали какую-то хрень, и все смеятся, да? Do not have bloopers, because if you have bloopers on the phone, you're not an expert, mm-hmm. right? It doesn't matter if the person on the phone has a net worth of $1 billion. If you're the only expert with that solution, let's go back to that doctor. Bill Gates is the richest man in the world, right? But if he goes to a doctor that only makes $1 million a year, it's not going to matter that, you know, Bill Gates flies on a private jet. That doctor is an expert. He's the only one that can help him, you know, fix whatever he got going on. It's the same thing with you. You're not a salesperson. You're not a telemarketer. You're a trusted advisor. I plan to be the top solutions advisor at this company this year. I'm not going to get there by being wrong. Let me introduce myself. Allow me to send out the information. All I want to do is give you our business track record. If you're not completely impressed with what I send you, I swear I will never call you again. Does that sound fair enough?
Yeah.
Fair enough. Closing. Yes.
I have a question. Let's imagine a real situation that all of us had lots of times on the phone. When you're talking on the phone to a potential customer and they say, look, I understand that you're good guys. I understand that you have best developers ever. All of them have PhDs, whatever. But I have a development center in India. Why should I pay more? For example, I buy them like for $18 per hour, and you sound like 38 per hour. Why should I pay more? Sometimes I have time to explain or to tell one story from my previous experience. The company we used to work closely for several years, I bet for 5 years already, they used to work with Indians. They have around 100 Indian employees working on their project. But they took us for QA, and they quit with Indians, and now only 10 people work on their project instead of 100. Sometimes you have the time to explain it to them. Sometimes you don't. They don't give you a chance. And I think it's better to present ourselves as an American company, as a US-based company with a development center in Eastern Europe. Because if we are talking about, we are a European company, we're from Russia, Belarus, they don't know it. They are getting suspicious about the situation with Ukraine, the situation with Russia. Of course, we are presenting ourselves as international company.
Yes,
and so my question is, finally, what words would make that guy on the phone change his mind?
Mm-hmm. What's the worst? What's the worst that can happen?
Mm-hmm. I'm likely I'll lose my money because I'm paying $18. You cost me $38. Mm-hmm. That's the difference. Mm-hmm.
Is it more expensive if you have to do it twice?
Mm-hmm.
So it's obvious, right?
Yes.
It's more expensive if you have to do it twice, right?
He answers, we do not have to do it twice. We are pretty satisfied with our vendors.
Okay. Yes,
we are satisfied.
Just like I said at the beginning of the call, Bob, I'm not calling to replace your existing vendors right now. This is not a sales call. It's not a recommendation call. We simply want to send out, because it's ABC, right? So A is your infantry, piechota. Where did Pasha go? Pasha don't care? Don't let him back in.
Pasha's going full.
Okay. It's ABC, right? So you have your A team. You have your killers that set up your scouts, right? They're out there searching for the target. Они готовят эту дичь для тебя, да? Ты приходишь, да, ты будешь как повар, ты ее сваришь, там приготовишь, то все, но ты как бы знаком уже с этой дичью, да, ты эксперт приготовить это, да. А потом account executives, они просто расставляют эти тарелки как бы и сервис the clients at the restaurant. So let me get back on track because I went off the line.
Right.
I'm off the line right now. So you tell them what's the worst that can happen, and then you ask them, if you do it, is it more expensive if you do it twice? And then you have to go into a metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter what you have, you have to show them a movie. You have to inspire images in their own head. Чтобы они сами представили ситуацию, где они пожалели там $2 или $3 или что-то такое, и получилось, что они какой-то товар хуже получили, с браком что-то. У вас была такая ситуация, где вы пожалели пару долларов, потом жалели, что просто не доплатили? So is it more expensive if you do it twice? It is your job and your responsibility to have the customer's best interest in mind. You cannot allow him to make the mistake that will hurt his business by choosing an inferior product. You cannot let him choose an inferior product because your company is the best thing on the market, your product is the best thing since sliced bread, and you're an absolute expert. So the story I use, right, is like, is it more expensive that you do it twice? If the customer is not a cocky bastard, he's an intelligent person, he's obviously going to say, yes, absolutely, it's going to cost more if I do it twice. And I started telling about how I bought my dream car, right? I bought a 350Z,
twin turbo, right? You guys don't have them here in Belarus, but so I bought a 350Z twin turbo. I was good enough a salesperson to convince my wife that it was her dream car. Because for like 3 years straight, I'm like, babe, you look really good in that car. It's so compact. You're small, it's small, it goes fast, you know, like da 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 da. So I was finally able to convince her that she loves this car. It's the best thing since sliced bread. It's the best car on the market. And Nissan is a company you can trust because the parts aren't that expensive. It's not going to break. Blah, 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 blah. Features and benefits. Long sales cycle, right? Once I got that car, one of the turbos went. I looked at my smartphone, and I looked at Yelp. I looked at the reviews. What's the best mechanic shop? Как у нас все выбирают автотелефоны, у кого ревью побольше, да? И вот этот mechanic shop слева, этот mechanic shop справа, да? Я зашел к одному, он мне там сказал 1500 штуки, я зашел к другому, он мне сказал 1300. Куда я пошел? Первая реакция. 1300, да? Я думаю машину, он говорит, блин, 2 дня все будет готово. Через 4 дня он мне звонит, говорит, все еще не готово. Через 7 дней, окей, приезжай. Я даю машину Насте, Настя заводит машину, там какой-то звук такой, блин, и ни хера, да, и не едет. А я к нему возвращаюсь, он говорит, не, это ваша проблема, вы что-то сплачем, что-то так не сделали, да, то есть там все херово, плохо. Если бы я потратил эти еще $200, сколько я время бы себе спас? Сколько вот нервов я бы себе спас бы?
И не факт, что ты спас бы.
Ну,
почему ты решил, что за 1500 или нет?
Потому что я к тому за 1500 взял, заплатил еще 1500, и все сделано было за 3 дня.
А, это потом. Только я не знал изначально.
Ну, то есть
это
поговорка, сколько ты платишь дважды, правильно?
Is it more expensive if you have to pay twice? If you're not completely overwhelmingly impressed with the information I provide, you'll never hear from me again. Fair enough? Any questions about any of these? I'll give you guys copies of everything and stuff like that tomorrow. So you'll have a whole wall. Oxygel is a boutique software development firm, taking only a handful of clients a year. But when we do pick a client, we're very careful about our selection, not to mismatch. I'm going to send you out the information if you're not 110% impressed. And believe me, your biggest problem is going to be that I didn't contact you sooner. Fair enough? It sounds funny. But millions of dollars are made with these words. Gee, I didn't wake up one day and invent these words. I'm not the best, you know, just sales guy for Oxygel that happens to have a lot of experience with American sales training, okay? A lot of the things I'm telling you right now made millions of dollars for companies. These words are proven. So what I want you to do is just to get these inhibitions out of your body, okay? Open up your minds and open up your hearts and try to embrace these new ideas. Because believe me, they will help you. If they think they won't, you're in the wrong industry. Point blank. Not everybody should be in sales. Right, Bobby? I'm just kidding. Okay, so let's try that, okay? Let's say I have a developer, right? And you're going to say, I understand you're not interested right now. Say it. I understand you're not interested right now.
I should repeat?
Yeah, repeat after me.
I understand that you are not interested right now.
Slow down. I understand.
I understand.
2 seconds. What? It's like 2 or 3 seconds. So it's, I understand, and then pause. Let it sink in. Let it go into their mind. I understand that you're not interested right now. Believe me, I'm not looking to interfere with your current development process.
Oxygel is a boutique development firm. We only pick a few customers a year. Let me get this information down the road to you. You know, if you're not 110% impressed, I'll never contact you again. Let me introduce myself. My name is Billy. I've been with Oxygel for 99 years. I'm the Grand Super Champion Vice President of the Sales Department. You know, everybody should be the head of sales. You're the head of Solutions Department. You're the head of sales. You're the Chief Vice President. Okay. Okay. So let's do this. Let's do this from the. Are you comfortable with this? You want me to pick somebody else? Nico, let's do this. Play along.
Okay, sure.
Okay. I understand you're not interested right now.
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 It's not one word in the sentence. And please don't laugh while I have other people, you know. It's uncomfortable. So, I understand you're not interested right now.
I understand.
I understand
you're not interested right now.
Sincere. See that? I love you. I completely understand. I'm such an understanding guy. Believe me, Billy, I'm not looking to replace your current development process. Say, believe me. Like, believe me. Прекрасти не это слово, да? Believe me, Billy.
Believe me, Billy. I'm not looking into changing your current vendor.
Yeah, say whatever. We're not looking to change things right now. It's no big deal. Mm-hmm. You know, it's only a blah, blah, blah. It's not a sales call. It's not a recommendation call. So you say, I understand you're not interested right now. But Billy, believe me, all I'm trying to do is send you out our track record. I can change this a million times, right? Mm-hmm. Well, for you guys, you would read exactly what it is. Mm-hmm. All I'm trying to do is send you out a track record right now. Say that. All I'm trying to do
is to send out a track record right now.
This isn't a sales call.
I should repeat?
Yeah, repeat after me. This isn't a sales call.
This isn't a sales call.
If after receiving the information, you're not 110% impressed.
You are not 100% impressed.
I will never contact you again. Fair enough?
I will never contact you again. Fair enough?
Body language. You know? Mm-hmm. Watch Italian people. Italian people, da la da la la la. The pizza, you know what I mean? It's all about body language. Mm-hmm. Believe me. We're not looking to replace your current development process. All we're looking to do is send you out our track record. If you're not 110% impressed, You will never hear from our firm again. Fair enough?
You're all a little tired. Why don't we do rounds of questions and stuff? What's like bugging you guys? What information would you really like to know? Maybe we can bring up objections. Because up until now, I want to split this up into A and B. Like, today's part A. It's mainly for the initial contact to get the appointment, right? Tomorrow we're going to go more into like sales, closing the sale, you know, reaffirming that you're the best, or maybe like we brought up instances when you make a sale and there's 3 to 4 weeks before a close happens or a contract is signed or any kind of work is delivered or anything like that. We're going to go into stalls, you know, asking for permission to stall, how to stall, just mainly closing stuff, you know. So it'll be good for you guys too, like, you know, because you need to close appointments too.
you know. But for now, we have 50 minutes left, unless my clock is wrong. Is right now 1:10? 1:15. Okay, so we have 45 minutes left. Well, at least I'm not on American time. Who has a question? Raise your hand. Who has a question?
I have a question. Sometimes I have such contacts. I feel that they are willing, that they are interested, but seeing girls like that, that for example, he writes me a message after my calls. I haven't spoken to him, but because he was busy, and so just sent him some emails, and then he asked me, okay, I would like to speak with your executives, you know. But that, we introduce our executives, I introduce the executive who will talk to him then. And he writes me, you know, I'm busy now, next week, yeah. Then, of course, I call him, when I don't get a message, a feedback from him, of course, I call him and say, okay, but then he switched to voicemail, something like that, and I feel that he's not so warm.
He's avoiding him.
Yeah, he's avoiding me, and what should I do? Because I have, currently I have about 3 contacts like that, and it makes me like, you know, I want to get them, and they're just like running away from me. So each week I try to call them, and I like to get that contact to make the lead, because I feel that he is quite good client.
Okay. So it's not something that you actually do, it's just something that you actually say. You go back to the script. So you say, Mr. Prospect, I've done thousands of these calls.
Mm-hmm.
I've been doing this for years. And every time I do this presentation, I get one of 3 outcomes. I either get a yes, and believe me, I love a yes. I either get a no. No's are okay, I'll take a no as gracefully as I'll take a yes.
Mm-hmm.
But the one outcome, the one answer that turns me into a pest, makes you uncomfortable, you have changed voicemails, things of that nature, is when you give me a maybe or give me a call in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
If this is what you want to do, at least get the information that says we're the best thing since sliced bread, let's do it. Monday or Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not, great. Like I said, we're not trying to rule your development portfolio, you know? But if it's a maybe, all it's going to do, we don't want to waste your time, we don't want to waste our time.
Yeah.
Is this something that you really want to do? If so, when? Just give them an option of 3.
Mm-hmm.
You know? You either get a yes,
mm-hmm.
you either get a no, or you get a maybe. Remember, like I said that line before when we were talking on the Skype call. But maybes don't make money. Maybes didn't build the wall of China. You know, they were either going to do it or they weren't going to do it. So it's sometimes it's better to get a no than it is to get a maybe.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to walk away from clients. There's so many of them. You know, especially we're in a B2B market. There's a lot of business. But does that answer your question
yeah.
a little bit?
А сам говорит нет, но это хороший клиент, и ты понимаешь, что он тебе нужен. Если нет, он закрывает все двери.
Ну вот смотри, скажем, я влюбился в Настю, да. И она мне говорит нет, 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 нет. Да, я буду follow-up где-то месяц 14. Но eventually it's gonna be harassment. Eventually the cops are gonna be called.
Так это maybe. И довести потом до нет, чем услышать от него нет.
Maybe
it's no. Maybe is no. Maybe means no. It's just not a solid no. Okay. So there's mystery, and then there's confidence. When do you feel the strongest? When you have a confident yes or no, or when you have a mysterious maybe?
Yes or no.
Yes or no is a better way to go, because if you get a yes, then it goes down a sales line. If you get a no, it gets disqualified.
Mm-hmm.
If you get a maybe, you're wasting your time with that person instead of going after a new yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Will you give up clients that are giving you maybes if you can't turn them into a yes or no?
Mm-hmm.
No.
What should I do? For example, he writes me, I don't have time this week. Let's do that next week. Should I call again and leave my voicemail, or should I just write him a message with three options? Or should I just, you know, follow up him for some period?
Like if he writes you an email and says next week, send him an email with three date options.
Again, next week.
Monday, Tuesday,
Wednesday. I have
such a friend
which is already a lead, like Dan, I don't know his name, he's from Belgium. And every time I get the same message, I was ill for 2 weeks and I couldn't call him because there was a problem with my voice.
Right.
And I wrote him when I was ill on my sick leave, I wrote him a message that we wanted to schedule that conference call. When do you have your time? And we have such options. And again, I got the same message that I don't have time now. I will check my my time slots on Monday. And he wrote me that on Friday when I was on sick leave.
You're talking about them?
Yeah. I get back on, and I see that his company, I mean, it's quite good.
Mm-hmm.
Not so bad, you know. On Monday, I wrote him same message that today is Monday, when you will send us your time slot, no sounds. I called him on Tuesday. So now I don't know what to do. I mean.
Well, here's the thing, right? You know about this guy, Don, right? So obviously it's not a lead anymore.
Yeah.
It's been passed on
mm-hmm.
to the salesperson.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It is now a salesperson opportunity, responsibility to either qualify or disqualify
mm-hmm.
that person. It's not your job. Your job is to set appointments. Your job is to turn a cold call into a sales
yeah,
call.
That's the thing that I want to do because he had interest.
Mm-hmm.
I know that he had it, and I would like to make that, I mean, to make him leave, but maybe he is really busy, so you never know. I don't know if he...
See, like, here's the thing, right? You are judged on how many leads you produce.
Mm-hmm.
We are judged on what we do with those leads. Does that make sense? You
yeah.
produced a lead. You took a cold, you went on LinkedIn or you found this guy somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
You generated interest in him. You sparked the fire in his heart.
Mm-hmm.
Moving, like you said, steps, right?
Mm-hmm.
He went up a few steps. So you started right here, went up a few steps and passed it on to the salesperson. It is now the salesperson's responsibility to
mm-hmm.
deal with that.
So that's a real, I mean, this is very important. When sometimes we don't understand what next step is. Should I call or should the salesperson do that?
Look, once you get a commitment, is Monday or Tuesday better? They say Tuesday, you're done. I don't know, maybe you guys sound like a confirmation email.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you get the confirmation
yeah.
email. In your emails, you have the option where it shows that the email's been open, it's been read, whatever. Once you get that confirmation that the email's been read, the information has been transferred, your job,
mm-hmm.
as far as I see it, you know,
mm-hmm.
I don't speak for the entire company, whatever, but in the multi-million dollar companies that I've been with, where there's a multi-layer sales funnel, everybody has a specific job to do,
mm-hmm.
you know? So your job is complete when that prospect gives you a commitment. The runaround is something we deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Salespeople deal with runarounds, right? You know? So, Wash, what do you think about that? Do you think she should keep following that person up, or should he be disqualified? Or if he's not a waste of time, you know, what should we do then?
I
just
think we should try to follow up with,
this week.
Finally
then
get the appointment set up.
Was there an appointment set initially?
No. He was stuck at choosing the slot.
Oh, there was no commitment.
No, not commitment.
There was
no appointment. The person expressed some interest, but nothing.
But he didn't say Tuesday
no.
or whatever. Oh, if there is no commitment,
mm-hmm.
he didn't move up the step.
Mm-hmm.
Then you stay with that
yeah.
person.
What
but
I do now.
yeah. But there has to be a limit. You can't keep going and going and going and going. Is this guy on the Fortune 500 list?
Mm.
No.
What list does he want?
Oh, no, I don't remember.
Is there only a small amount of others like him?
He's not so special. I mean, that's...
What makes him special enough for him to use your time? Because your time is valuable.
For me, I have now one contact with, which is quite special for me. I mean, he's a director of a company which is more than 10,000 people. And this company is quite, I feel that it's a good opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and he's quite also a busy man, and I try to, I almost set up a meeting with him in the United Kingdom, and he was ready for that meeting. But then our plans changed, and he felt, you know, I feel also same as that person feels that we, first I set up that meeting, then I said, oh, our director can't go to the United Kingdom at that time. And then I understand that this person feels that we are not so...
Serious?
Yeah, that we are not so serious. What should I do? I mean that I wrote him a message, oh, I'm sorry, not like sorry, but that our plans changed, so let's set up...
Did the director write an email and apologize?
No.
Но кто должен был ехать?
Наш
Дима. Дима должен был. Как бы prospect knew that you put Dima's name, right?
Это Дан был.
Нет, это другое.
Это Шнайдер, вот это Шнайдер.
То есть как бы у нас по поводу этого контакта тоже сомнения возникли, потому как когда он мне ответил, знаешь, вот пока вы там решали с этим митингом, он мне написал. Я уже свои ниццы, типа, уже все решил с некоторыми компаниями, которые были... То есть мы как бы вот растягивали, наверное, две недели. Да, мы на две недели растянули этот митинг, потому что мы сами не знали, будет ли он точно. То есть ради какой компании ехать, если как бы мы сами не понимаем еще толком, что ему надо. Хотя он мне сказал, что ему надо, какие приложения ему надо.
Ну, как бы смотри, it's again, it's a sales funnel, right? Let's say you set an appointment for me, it's out of your hands. If I accept the appointment, and appointment is set for Tuesday, I'm scheduled to go for Tuesday, my dog gets sick on Monday and I can't go because my puppy's sick, I feel personal, I'm not speaking for anybody else, but it is my responsibility to send that email, not to hide behind my assistant or behind my appointment setter and saying, hey, my appointment setter sent this letter. I feel if it's been assigned to me, it is my responsibility to write and say the reason why I cannot meet.
I understand
that. Does that make sense? I mean...
Но мы до этого уровня еще даже не дошли. То есть как бы он вообще нашел меня в LinkedIn. То есть как бы все было очень так вот...
Вот как я понял твою ситуацию, которую ты мне только что описал, да? Вот, да, ты позвонила чуваку, чувак согласился на встречу была скеджерована, тогда ответ
был... Сначала, с самого начала, просто я как бы начала с самой, вот, ну, как бы, маленькой.
Это не проблема даже, ну, как бы, просто...
Давай раз, два, три, да?
Сначала, он нашел меня в LinkedIn, он мне написал, что, типа, сначала я вообще серьезно не восприняла, потому что я, честно говоря, ну, как бы, судила как по национальному, ну, как бы, то, что он...
Индусский или что там?
Ну, как бы сначала он мне просто написал, типа, мне бы хотелось с вами поговорить, мне интересно узнать что-либо о вашей компании. То есть, вначале мне было, типа, непонятно, то есть, что с ним делать. Потом я посмотрела, компания там хорошая, типа, столько людей там нанято, и смотрю, какие девелоперы, то есть у него там United Kingdom based, headquarters в United Kingdom, работают у него там французы, англичане и все так далее. Вот, потом...
Давай сделаем просто, смотри. Раз, два, три, четыре, да.
То есть все было в LinkedIn.
Окей.
У него был интерес.
Окей. Был интерес.
Да, интерес. А у нашей компании я ему написала. Ну это просто как пример. Мы не воспринимаем это сейчас как что-то такое
суперсерьезное.
Да, кейс.
Safe zone. This is safe zone. It's safe zone. Okay. Okay. So there was a tension. Okay.
Yes.
So there was a tension. He had interest.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I sent him like basic information about us, mm-hmm. you know, just like written form, what we do, with whom we work. So he said, okay, I'm looking for your call. And he wrote me his number, mobile phone.
Okay.
I called him, and then at this time we had that meeting that we could set up that meeting, mm-hmm. and I told him, okay, you know that. By the way, we can set up that meeting in person. Yeah, personal, face to face. So, and she said, yeah, that sounds great.
then I understood that at this period then we can't set up.
Everything has changed.
Yes. The plans changed.
Well, that's out of your control. I mean, did you know beforehand?
No, of course not.
Then how could you know?
Then, after I understood that there won't be any meetings, I just suggested to set up the conference call with no executives. And he also, when I spoke to him, he told me, if there is no meeting, set up conference call with your director, not executives. Yeah, but we can't do that. We don't do like that. He wanted to speak with director, but the first step is executives. Yeah,
it would be okay.
Yeah, but so and then I felt sorry that I just promised one thing and then no meeting and conference call. He said, okay, conference call next week. And then he wrote me, oh, my plans changed. And while we were thinking about that meeting, 2 weeks passed and I already found some other companies to do that. My small needs were covered, completed. But he still feels like interest in our company.
Okay, what could we have done better? As a company, as a process, from that experience, what could have been done differently in order for it to work out better?
I think that meeting will work better, but at the same time, I actually don't know. I felt not so comfortable when he told me that he already completed all his tasks, I mean his projects, so maybe it's a very small project, so, and he...
No, you were just working with the information that you had. New information was entered into the equation, and it threw out, what the answer would have been if everything was as you thought it was.
And what I did, I just after my sick leave, I also called him on Monday, left my voicemail, and then wrote him in LinkedIn because emails he doesn't answer to emails.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. So and he told me that okay, this week I don't have time. Next week maybe. And I just wrote him not formal like informal message that okay, if you have time next week, just drop me a mess with the time slot.
Then move on,
mm-hmm.
move on. Do not linger. Salespeople can linger.
Mm-hmm.
We can get bitter and take it personal, mm-hmm. even though we shouldn't. But for us, it's every opportunity that we get from you or from Misha or from anywhere, it means a lot because it's an opportunity to bring the company money and to fill our own pocket. So I will follow up. For you, it's a wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, more of a thing. It's like, hello, would you like something? You don't like something? All right, goodbye. You know
mm-hmm.
what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
Please let me send out some information if you're not 110%, blah, 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 blah. So for you, it's just to get it to the next stage and then move on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, move on. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't take it home with you. You know, just like you walk into the office, you don't bring your home stuff to the office, you don't take your office stuff home with you. You know? So that's my answer to that. You know, but the process has to be the same every time. Everybody has to be on the same page. We're a team. We're not
mm-hmm.
an individual person.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Can we move on to the next question? Okay. I'd like to get one from the sales side. Like, Washington, can you give me a good scenario or like? How would you do it in this situation? How would you do it in that situation? That would help.
You want me to give a scenario of kind of what happened?
Моя мозги другие, чем белорусские мозги. У меня менталитет совершенно другой. То есть моя реакция на ту же самую вещь, как у тебя случилось с каким-то человеком, будет другая. Maybe you guys can take something from it. You know what I mean? If you don't have one right now, who has one?
No, you don't have one. Get your wishes.
Okay, Murray, do you have one?
Actually, probably it's not the direct like answer
answer to your question, but the situation is very similar to Lena's one. But it happened when Lena has passed the opportunity to me already. So I faced the same situation. I had a conversation with the client. He confirmed his interest. And at the end of the day, he disappeared. And I've been calling to him for 3 months. I remember correctly. Everybody in the office knew who is Sanders Wooster.
Because he never told me about his past project. So.
Yeah, I finally got in touch with him in 3 months. He said, I'm not the fastest person to answer the calls and emails.
No shit, you know.
So,
okay. 3 months.
How shall we consider this situation in terms of like qualification and disqualification of this opportunity? Mm-hmm. Leave him as an opportunity and proceed following
up? Depends.
Oh no.
What was the dollar value?
It's a team of 3 people. So
was it worth your time?
I make decisions here because I am the director of the company, and if somebody else in my company thinks that that it's not necessary for now, I will say that it is.
That's bullshit. Nobody does that. It's the same thing like a husband and wife. A husband goes to the store to buy a TV, and he's like, I make the decisions in that house.
Yeah.
I don't need to talk to my wife about buying this $1,000 TV. But when it comes down to it, all I need is your agreement here, here, and here. You know what? Let me talk to my wife about it.
Yeah. Exactly.
Let me talk to my wife about it. It's bullshit. Don't believe it.
So just disqualify.
No. What you do is you ask, is there anybody else we should share this information with as
yes,
a benefit?
He said yes. And he promised me to introduce me to his project manager. And I've been waiting for this introduction for years.
To avoid any kind of cultural differences, just to make sure our team will fit your company culture, let me speak to the person who will be directly working with the team.
Mm-hmm. I will send you an email. I will make, let's arrange an introductory call for next week.
Mm-hmm.
He has confirmed it in his calendar. So
I've confirmed a lot of meetings in my Google Calendar.
He's accepted my invitation, but no introduction was made to PM.
Did you speak to him before the meeting? Did you send him anything prior to the meeting?
Yes, I did. A number of follow-ups,
mm-hmm.
Brochures, marketing materials, repeating the same information, I'm sure, that Lena provided. So, a number of actions, but no feedback and no.
Did you call to follow up on the information you sent?
Yes, exactly. It was a pleasure for me to talk to his secretary at the time when he was not available.
Okay. Well, look, if you have a situation like this and you have somebody telling you, I'm the only decision maker, you know it's bullshit. Because there's a symbiotic relationship with somebody else. Okay, he doesn't
mm-hmm.
pay all the bills. He doesn't deal with all the team members. Find out who else is involved.
Mm-hmm.
Start interviewing these people. Maybe you're going to be able to find a champion inside a company. What I mean by champion is a person who will help you sell your company to the company.
Mm-hmm.
Make friends with somebody else there. You know, offer some sort of an incentive. So that they maybe could influence from the inside. Or maybe they could be like, hey, Bob, Marina's been calling you. Are you an asshole? You've been calling for 2 weeks. Okay, talk to Marina, right? But here's what I do, right? I never do anything without permission. So me sending you information gives me permission to call you. It's reciprocating, right? So say if I speak to you on Monday, and then I'm supposed to speak to you on Friday, I'm at least going to speak to you 2 or 3 times before Friday. So I'm going to send you some follow-up stuff to recap what we talked about, the information on the email. Then a few hours go by, I'm going to call. If the secretary answers, I'm like, oh, hey, Betty, it's Al from Oxygel. Is John in? Oh, hey, Betty, not, Hi, how you doing? My name is Alex from Paul from Oxygel. I spoke to Bob earlier. Can you put me through? You don't say that. You say, oh, hey, Betty, because you probably already know the secretary by then.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody in his company also knew me as well.
Yeah, you're part of the family by now.
Exactly. But no money. Where is money here? How to make it?
The money's going to come from his team members. It's going to come from his wife. The wife is going to make the final decision. You know? We can beat our chests. I make the decisions around here. Who's actually going to... Yeah, the wife is the boss. In this case, he has a boss. He has team members. So the director doesn't directly direct the development team. He has other duties. So what I would have done in that situation is I would try to start a dialogue with the person who will be commanding the ship, you know? Talk to the captain, but also talk to the crew chief. Who's running the men on the boat? Who's making sure there's no mutiny? You get the reference? Да? Как бы можно говорить с генералом, да, можно говорить с сержантом, который сидит со своими пацанами, знаешь, они в бою, да. Генерал сидит в офисе, пишет планы, говорит, я делаю все решения, а сами сержанты, его бойцы, они, they're in the trenches. So that's just a suggestion, you know, get to know other people. You have LinkedIn, see who else works at that company. Start a dialogue in the company, ask opinions. Say, hey, I'm speaking with Bob. Later, do you think you would have interest in this thing? Do you think you would like this information that I'm sending him? You know what I mean? Like, just social. Be social. Would you like me to elaborate more on that? Or? Okay, what part exactly would you like me to elaborate on? Mm-hmm.
I'm
trying. Yeah, what should I have done now? That's what уже прошло.
Yeah.
Дофига, мы его уже закрыли, наверное, месяц назад мы его закрыли. Лина передала мне его
летом,
да, и вот я ему...
Я помню.
Все лето наяривала, с июня месяца. В конце августа где-то он мне там сказал, что I'm not the fastest person, so on, so...
Нет, так это же генерал?
Да, да.
Так вот они на самом деле не фаст вообще.
Нет, мне кажется, когда им надо, они все очень фаст. Я уже родить успею к тому времени.
Сети пой бы вы не кэд.
Я ему так и пишу.
I got a junior executive. He's been doing this for approximately 9 months now. You know, he's an expert in the field.
Baby shower.
You know, I'm back and I'm calling you again.
I have no time.
Okay, let's kind of get back on topic, right? So right now we're dealing with the runaround situation, right? What I've answered to, as far as my understanding over there, when it's navies and things of that nature, let's all agree that it's better to have a confident yes or no than a mysterious maybe someday. If you're getting a runaround with your POC, your point of contact, find another point of contact. He has to have some coworkers that he works with. LinkedIn, look at his Facebook thing. You know what I mean? Click on one that endorse him on the LinkedIn thing. He'll have to get some sort of email in his inbox that you've endorsed him. Then he'll see your face come up again. Mm-hmm. Be everywhere. Be everywhere at the same time. harass this person, okay? Sir, that's how much we value your business. Yes.
Ну вот, когда ты встречаешь какие-то митинги, appointments, да, ну, не секрет, иногда мы делаем, это называется спам-рассылка, да, и иногда в одну компанию попадает два письма, например, одно SEO, второе CTO, да, и когда, например, тебе SEO отвечает, нет, нам не интересно, а CTO тоже компания, окей, давайте митинг организуем. Вот у меня очень много таких случаев было, что делать.
Ну смотри, вот, скажем, ты продаешь какой-то процесс оптимизировать что-то в компании, да, скажем, финансы. У тебя есть какой-то процесс, где можно снизить cost of doing business. Do you think the secretary cares about how much it costs to keep the lights on in the building? Or do you think that the chief financial officer cares about how much it costs to keep the lights on in the building? Here's why I say this, is because people don't care about the big picture. Small people don't care about the big picture. If you're not specifically assigned to that role, you don't care about it. So SEO doesn't care about development of whatever you are selling to that person. Only the CTO cares about the development of that person. If you called with a new link building strategy to tell them how to optimize their AdWords better so they organically show up higher on the search engines, SEO will care about that. Does that make sense?
А если наоборот?
Не понял.
SEO не хочет, а CTO хочет.
Так я же говорю.
Наоборот, точнее.
Ну, can SEO make a decision that the CTO is responsible in making? Я вот смотри, вот ты меня спросила, да?
Yeah.
Вот вы ссылаете две ссылки,
yeah.
одинаковое что-то, да?
Yeah.
Да. И там одно и то же
предложение. Одна попала к Диме, вторая к Сергею Курчуку.
They're going to react totally differently. Сергей is a technical person. Дима is more, you know, sales, motivation, marketing. He carries a vision for the company. The CTO cares about the work being done. The CEO cares about there being enough work coming in for the CTO to take care of. So we all have duties. И когда ты мне говоришь, что смотри, письмо вышло двум департаментам, в какой именно департамент ты хочешь продавать? Ты продаешь SEO services или ты продаешь technical services?
Ну тут не важно кому, тут главное, например, ну, если я продам CTO,
что
они
говорят... Что ты продавала? Ты dedicated team
продавала?
You're a
seller marketer? Ними, да.
Well, who did you need to meet with?
CTO, конечно.
CTO.
So, при чем SEO?
Он потом скажет, а нам не нужны эти ребята.
Ну, это ж потом будет.
Uh-huh.
То есть в компании есть такие CTO, которые выросли из девелоперов, которые не думают о костах, которые просто в работе. Они как, ну, как BM, хотя называются CTO.
Uh-huh.
В таких случаях надо с CTO разговаривать,
uh-huh.
потому что они будут решать, выгодно, невыгодно, отсутствие.
Все равно CTO пойдет потом к SEO, все равно.
Ну окей, он пойдет и ему скажет, хорошо, я отказал этой компании. Я, скорее всего, он даже не вспомнил письмо. Ну, вдруг. Вот если скажет, а что ты это отказал? Ну, не знаю, они из Беларуси. Да, они из Беларуси, но они там работают по нашим, там, по супер-пупер ставкам. У них как раз есть те люди, которые нам сейчас нужны. SEO мы не знаем, что им нужно там 5 долларов завтра.
В общем, быстро это так.
А, SEO как CEO? Я думал, SEO как Search Engine Optimization.
Нет, SEO,
SEO. А, окей, все, а я тут про какие-то алгоритмы рассказываю, начинаю. Окей, я думал, ты сказал Search Engine Optimization. Да-да-да, смотри. CEO is sales, okay? A CEO is a master salesperson, okay? A CTO is a master IT person. Okay? So this guy is going to have to deal with what you are selling. This guy is going to make the decision on whether it gets funded or not. Okay? Your job right now is to make a logical case here. And that is to make an emotional case here. Okay? Because this is an emotional person. This is a logical person. Once they come together and agree that logically it makes sense to the technical person and emotionally makes sense to the salesperson, we're going to get some money. Disagree? Does it make sense? What's up?
I agree, because in our telemarketing job, we always, if one person we know, we call straightly to the other one and he might say yes.
Mm-hmm.
We never accept one no from the company. It doesn't matter whether it's CEO or CTO.
From the same company.
From my experience,
mm-hmm.
I've been chasing for one company, I don't know, for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, my American colleague has been chasing for this company. I called to all of the executives and to all of the management staff. chief executive officer, senior vice president of engineering, vice president of engineering, CTO, SVP of technology, SVP of information, whatever. And some of them said, no, we're not interested. We have already found the partner. Okay, I switched to the other person. He said, you know, this guy, VP of engineering, he is responsible for outsourcing. You can try him. I opened up the record in the Salesforce, and I saw that I've been chasing for him like for lots of time, for 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then I kept calling him, like three calls, three emails. He answered to my second email saying, yes, I want to talk to your executives. And it ended up with the deal. We signed a contract, but it took us like almost 4 years to get into. I knew everyone within this company. Everyone knew me. I don't know. I just it was a follow up. It's not difficult for me to pick up the phone and make one call. It will last like 1 minute.
Yeah.
Eventually, why 1 minute within the American market, you'll leave a voicemail.
Why not?
If you talk to a person, it would be good. So. It was like this.
И бывает действительно очень хорошие ситуации, когда там CEO очень занят, и он сам говорит, я представлю там своего коллегу, да, который вот спускается на уровень ниже. Это отлично. А бывает такое, когда они тебе говорят, ну хорошо, я поговорю там с Биллом, и если Билл заинтересуется, то ну окей, мы. Но я не знаю, что он скажет Биллу. Скорее всего, он скажет, ну какая-то девочка из Беларуси там звонила.
Сама,
то есть,
сама
вот,
найди Билла.
Хорошо, если я знаю фамилию Билла, то есть, ну вот. А как правило, это идет одним письмом, что окей, мы там обсудим внутренний, и все, и больше они тебя уже
не могут.
Смотри, да, вот опять же я говорю, да, если CEO говорит, звони CTO.
Звони, тогда я звоню. А если он говорит, я сам ему там что-то про вас скажу.
Just so there's no loss in communication. Allow me to share the information with the two of you if it makes you more comfortable, or at least let me send some information to him ahead of time for his review. If he is not 110% impressed with the information he receives, there's no need for you to waste your time, Mr. SEO. Please allow me to send, because I'm an expert, because I'm the best thing since sliced bread. Only rookies leave things up to chance, okay? Experts take steps to make things happen, okay? So over here, you're selling features, okay? So feature and benefit, right? Over here, you're selling benefits. Features are technical, benefits are emotional, okay? So if this guy says, okay, call him or I'll talk to him, okay? And you start blabbing off features to the SEO, the CEO, he's not gonna care. So the amount of energy that he's going to transfer to the CTO is going to say that he doesn't care. Mm-hmm. So you say, Mr. CEO, for your benefit and ours, please allow me to share the information so that way it transfers in the proper light. I don't want to disadvantage our CTO by not giving him exactly what he wants because we're experts in our field. Does that make sense?
Yep. So you mean we have used different approaches to different, like, calling different people like CEO, CTO, I mean technology person, and who is not technology but who is in management.
Yeah.
Different list of questions, different sales people.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, because the mentality is different. Mm-hmm. You're selling to the different, right? So some people are kinetic, they like to touch things,
mm-hmm.
Okay? Some people are visual, mm-hmm. They want to see things. Then other people are auditory. So they like to hear things. You cannot sell to a kinetic person the same way you would sell to an auditory person. You are the same thing, a vision person. He has to see it. And then some people are a mix. They're kinetic, they're auditory, and they're vision. You know, they have to see everything, you know? Like me, I'm a vision person, you know? I'd rather see it, you know, so I can understand it. If you tell me, I probably won't get it, you know what I mean? But different people, you sell them different styles, different tone of voice, different words are being used, like that line, you know, please let me introduce myself, I'm the best thing since sliced bread, it's going to work better with the CEO. Mm-hmm. To the CTO, I've been doing this for 10 years, I'm a senior solution advisor. I plan to be the best this year. I'm not going to get there by being wrong. So best and not being wrong means you're a technical person, means you know the technique to be the best, and you know the technique, you know, not to be worse, because, you know, trial and error. Does that make sense?
Of questions. Questions.
Okay, so just to wrap up real quick, okay? From now on, just try it. You're not gonna go and make a sales call right now and remember most of this. But some of this will sink in, and I'm gonna make sure it sinks in, because we're gonna have like a Skype webinar or something like that, where I'm gonna like just quiz you guys once every 3 weeks or something like that on information that I'll share with you on email and things of that nature. Because just like smoking, it takes a few times for it to become a habit. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't you agree, the first time you smoked a cigarette, it was nasty? It's a habit. It's going to take 45 to 60 days of doing these things, of imagining the straight line, of knowing that this is the start, this is the promised land, it's the finish, of knowing that the sale doesn't start until they say no. If they don't say no, you're selling shoes in a shoe store, okay? There's going to be some walls that you have to overcome. You have to remember that the first no you get, you do a large, vague loop. Well, maybe you're saying no because you don't have enough information about our company. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you this. Oxygel is the best thing since sliced bread. You keep going, blah, 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 blah. They say no again. Well, perhaps you're saying no because you don't trust me, and I understand you don't trust me. How could you trust me? It's a 30-second phone call. Please give me 1% of confidence and allow me to earn the other 99. Blah, 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 blah. Then you do it again. As far as, and the beauty of this program is, you know, and you just say, it's low risk, high reward. This is a cash outlay. This is an investment. We're going to take you by the hand. We're going to do it by the numbers. We're going to do this step by step. We're not just going to give this to you and say, hey, you figure out. We're going to take you by the hand. We're going to take your team and walk them through step by step. We're going to be here for you. This is a benchmark for future business. Allow this first interaction to be a solid ground for blah, 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 blah. And just keep saying those things over and over. Как дети, да? Вот я мама говорит, вот постоянно что-то им говорит. То же самое. Look at these people like kids, right? So again, right? It just makes it easy for me. Straight line. If they go off the line, that sounds fascinating. And you know what? Let me tell you this. Or if they go off the line, they start talking about something completely different. They start talking about, well, you know, I'm a hunter. I love hunting. I love fishing. I like baking cookies. I like doing a lot of things. You don't want to say that shit sounds stupid and I don't hunt, bake cookies, or fish. You say, wow, Mr. Prospect, that sounds great. I hope someday I'll get a chance to hunt, bake cookies, and fish. But for now, I'm just a senior advisor here at Oxygen.
So let me become a CEO.
Get back to the loop. Some statistics, sale, like 70 or 80% of sales don't happen until like the sixth or seventh no. Okay? And the bad thing is, well, good for us, is that 90% of salespeople quit on the first no. They take it emotionally. They're not ready. They're not ready because they don't have the words to say. Mm-hmm. Learn the words. You will never be stuck again. You can just take them in loops and loops and loops. Пока вы их не закроете вот в такую тупую коробку, you have to box them in. Put them in a box. You have to build a logical box. You have to build an emotional box. The logic will justify the price. The emotion will justify the decision to buy and will avoid any cancellation after they buy. There's only one or two things that can happen when they're in a box. They're either going to buy or they're going to hang up the phone. But the thing is, you're going to be able to close anybody who's closable. You'll, once you learn the words to say, you're not going to wonder. Maybe Pasha could have got that sale. Maybe Tanya could have got that sale. Maybe Billy, Jilly, or Willie could have got that sale, but not me. You're going to know that you did everything possible in order to close the sale. That's it. So that's it for today. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.